chapter 15, it's about the ANS and the PNS, or autonomic nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Autonomic means autonomous, self-governed, independent. So autonomic nervous system is the branch of the nervous system that works independently of our will. It helps us to control the homeostasis of different physiological processes in our body, like heart rate, blood pressures, and body temperature. And the autonomic nervous system is subdivided into sympathetic and parasympathetic systems. So the ANS, it's a motor nervous system that helps to control secretion in glands, the functioning of the cardiac muscle and the smooth muscle. And this is also known as visceral motor system, because the cardiac muscle, along with other types of muscle like the smooth muscle, it is found in viscera, or in internal organs that we have within the thorax and within the abdominal cavity. And it's motor because it helps to control the movement of such muscles. So what are the primary organs of the ANS? Viscera of the thoracic and abdominal cavities, so the heart, the lungs, the digestive tract, and others like urinary bladder. So some of the structures of the body wall are also innervated by the ANS, like the blood vessels in our skin, our sweat glands, and the muscles in our skin that we call piloerector muscles. ANS, as we said before, it works involuntarily. So without our conscious intent or awareness, we perform this functioning. So the ANS only adjusts the activity that the body needs to perform. And whenever we have what we call denervation hypersensitivity, we will have exaggerated responses of the cardiac and the smooth muscle if the ANS nerves are severe. This system is in charge of producing visceral reflexes that are unconscious, automatic, stereotyped, and that involves visceral receptors and the effector organs within these viscera, or these structures. We have a visceral reflex arc which has different components. So it has receptors that are located at the different surfaces of these organs, and these receptors are attached to or connected to nerve endings that can detect if an organ has stretch, if you have tissue damage within the organs, if you have changes in the chemicals within our blood, if you have changes in body temperature and other internal stimuli. The reflex arc, once it starts this signal through the receptors, is going to send this signal into the central nervous system using afferent neurons. And then within the CNS, we will have these centers that are specifically for the ANS that helps to integrate this information coming from the afferent neurons. And then they will process this information, and then they will send a signal back into these organs where you receive this signal through efferent neurons. And the efferent neurons will carry motor signals, and the effectors, once they receive these motor signals, will produce a response. Depending on what was the stimuli, what was the original signal, is going to be what type of response. So the ANS is considered part of the efferent pathway. So here we have an example of one of these visceral reflexes. This is called what we call the battle reflex. So within this blood vessel that we have here, that it is called the internal carotid, you have receptors that detect changes in pressure, in blood pressure. So these are called battle receptors. When these battle receptors are stimulated, they will send a signal and an action potential to this area of the brain, the medulla oblongata, using this nerve that we call the glossopharyngeal nerve or cranial nerve number 9. So when this glossopharyngeal nerve connects to this cardiovascular center within the medulla oblongata, it's going to relay the signal with this interneuron, and then is going to have this efferent pathway through this vagus nerve. So this was the afferent neuron, and this is the efferent neuron. This is the interneuron, and the integrating center will be the cardiovascular center. So using this efferent neuron, that it is part of the vagus nerve or cranial nerve number 10, you will have a signal that it is called effector signal, and it will help in this case to decrease the heart rate. So one of the functions of the vagus nerve is to decrease the heart rate whenever you have increased blood pressure. So that was the battle reflex. So these branches of the ANS, sympathetic and parasympathetic system, they innervate usually the same target organs with a few exceptions that we will see later on. So the organs, when they receive sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation, they will have what we call dual innervation. So one system is going to be more active than the other, but usually they are working to maintain homeostasis independently of which one is more active than the other. Now, in general, they have opposite effects. So we will see in this case what are the opposite effects. So sympathetic system, which is also known as the fight or flight, or also what we call the thoracolumbar system, it will prepare our body for physical activity, like for exercise, trauma, arousal, competition, anger, or fear. So whenever we activate the sympathetic system, we will have release of these neurotransmitters, like epinephrine and norepinephrine, that will increase the heart rate, the blood pressure. It will dilate our airway, so we'll have increased airflow into our lungs, and then our blood glucose levels will go up, so it will prepare us to fight. And in the skin, it will reduce the blood flow, and also in the digestive tract, because as we are prepared for an emergency, the skin and the digestive tract, they don't need as many blood supply, so that will go into our muscles so we can fight or flight. Parasympathetic system, it will have the opposite effect, so it will decrease the heart rate, decrease the blood pressure, it will constrict our airway, so we'll have less air coming into our lungs, and is this system that we call the craniosacral system, and it is also known as rest and digest. It will increase the mobility of the digestive tract and also help us to eliminate wastes. Because of this dual innervation that we have in many organs, we will have what we call autonomic tone. That will be the normal rate of activity in any organ according to the body needs. Parasympathetic system tone will maintain smooth muscle tone in the intestines, so we will have a specific rigidity or a structure within the tone of the smooth muscle, and it will maintain our heart rate to be in average between 70 to 80 beats per minute. Sympathetic system will keep most of our blood vessels vasoconstricted, and it will maintain the blood pressure. Parasympathetic system does not innervate our blood vessels, but sympathetic system does. And the sympathetic system will have an excitatory effect in our heart, but it will have an inhibitory effect in the digestive system and our urinary function. So the parasympathetic system, again, it will do the opposite effect. The ANS has components of both the central and peripheral nervous system. So you will have these nuclei within the hypothalamus and the pons or the medulla oblongata, the brainstem, that helps to control many of our homeostatic mechanisms. And you will have these motor neurons running in the spinal cord and in the peripheral ganglia, that it is just by the spinal cord. And some of these nerves will pass through these cranial foramina or skull foramina, and some of the fibers will go through the spinal nerves. The ANS has different functioning than the somatic motor pathway, the motor pathway that controls our skeletal muscle. So in the somatic pathway, you have a motor neuron that is coming from the brainstem or the spinal cord that reaches all the way to the skeletal muscle. So these are long nerves. In the autonomic pathway, you have this interconnection or this signal that goes across two neurons, and then you reach the target organ. So these two neurons synapse in what we call autonomic ganglions, which are located either next by the spinal cord or next by the organ that it is innervated. And the name of these two neurons will be presynaptic neuron, the one that it is located within the brainstem or the spinal cord, and the postsynaptic neuron that it is located within the ganglion, and it will extend all the way one axon to reach the target cell. So this is a comparison between the nerves of the somatic system and the autonomic nervous system. So in here we have this efferent motor neuron from the somatic nervous system that is going to innervate this skeletal muscle. Now this is a long neuron, myelinated, that releases acetylcholine so that you can have this action potential that leads to contraction of the skeletal muscle. In the sympathetic system, you will have these long neurons that will connect to these target organs. Now, for the sympathetic system, you will have this norepinephrine. This is the neurotransmitter. So you have this preganglionic fiber that will connect to these ganglions that are located nearby the spinal cord. And you will have this second neuron that is going to reach the heart muscle and it will send this signal. So in here, the connection between the preganglionic neuron and the postganglionic neuron, you have the release of acetylcholine. So this cell can depolarize and then they send the signal into the heart muscle through norepinephrine. In the parasympathetic system, you have this long neuron, the presynaptic neuron, that is going to connect to these ganglions that are located near to the target organ. And then you will have a short postsynaptic neuron that is going to release acetylcholine. So again, the other name for sympathetic nervous system will be thoracolumbar, because the nerves for this system exits spinal nerves T1 through L2. And this system also will form this ganglia that it's located on the sides of the spinal cord into what we call paravertebral ganglia. In the sympathetic system, the preganglionic neuron is relatively short, but it has long postganglionic fibers as we saw before. And then these two synapses at this ganglia. And usually, you have a series of longitudinal ganglia adjacent to the vertebral column from the cervical area into the coccygeal levels. You will have three ganglions within the cervical area, 11 within the thoracic, 4 within the lumbar, 4 within the sacral, and 1 within the coccygeal. And the sympathetic nerve fibers will then be distributed throughout the body after they have emerged from this ganglia. So this is a mid-sagittal view of these sympathetic nerves within the thoracic region. So we have here these nerve fibers that connects, in this case, to this thoracic ganglion. And then through this thoracic ganglion, you extend these nerves, these postsynaptic nerves, that are going to come and innervate part of the wall of the thoracic cavity, but they are going to come and innervate the heart muscle, and also they're going to innervate part of the lungs in here. And when you have series of ganglions together, of the sympathetic system, you call it sympathetic chain. So these are the sympathetic chain nerves. So this is the diagram to show you how these nerves emerge between T1 to L2. So you have all of these, and then they connect to these ganglia that we have on the sides of the spinal cord into what we call the paravertebral ganglia. Now these upper cervical nerves from the sympathetic system will go and innervate structures like the iris in our eye, the nasal glands. It will also innervate salivary glands like the sublingual gland, like the submandibular gland. And part of this will also come in to the heart, and it will innervate, of course, the heart. Part of them, it will come into the bronchi. And the ones that are emerging here from the thoracic region, they will come and innervate viscerae like the liver, the stomach, pancreas, spleen through this celiac ganglion. And through this sympathetic mesenteric ganglion, it will innervate the small intestines, part of the large intestines. And this celiac ganglion is going to come and go directly with this long nerve, this postsynaptic nerve, into the medulla of the adrenal gland, so we can release epinephrine into the bloodstream and we can have systemic effects. Also, these nerves are going to come here into the skin and innervate the blood vessels in our skin, and also this muscle, the erector pili muscle. This sympathetic system, through this inferior mesenteric ganglion, is going to innervate organs like the kidneys, urinary bladder, in the male, the penis, the scrotum, and in females, the uterus and the ovaries. The paravertebral ganglions are connected to the spinal nerve by two branches that we call communicating rami. So the preganglionic fibers are small myelinated fibers that goes from the spinal nerve into the ganglion by the Y communicating ramus. Why this nerve fiber is called Y communicating ramus? Because it has myelin. And then after this, these preganglionic fibers will connect to the postganglionic fibers in the ganglion, the paravertebral ganglion, and then these postganglionic fibers will exit this ganglion by the great communicating ramus, which is going to be unmyelinated. And this one can form a connection back into the spinal nerve, so it can go and be distributed together with the spinal nerve to the different target organs. So, this is the spinal cord. This is the lateral horns of the spinal cord. So in here you have these connections of the preganglionic fibers. These ones in green. So the preganglionic fibers exit with this motor nerve of the somatic system. And as they are emerging through this spinal nerve, some of them, they will go up to go and make connections to an upper level. Like if this was, let's say, T3, it can go and connect up to T2 or T1. If it can go up, and it can go down as well. It can go to T4 to T5. And as it's doing this, going up and down, it can make this synapse with postganglionic fibers. In this case, and they have to be at the ganglion, of course, as you can see here, all these ganglions. So when it does this, it will go, in this case, to the iris, salivary glands, lungs, heart, thoracic blood vessels, etc. And then it will go like this and form like a little loop around about. And this one is going to go together with this spinal nerve, and it will go and innervate sweat glands, pyroerector muscles, and blood vessels of the skin and skeletal muscles. Now, it will also go down, and it will connect to another type of ganglions that, instead of being of the paravertebral ganglion or the sympathetic chain, it will be what we call the collateral ganglion. And then this collateral ganglion is going to have these bodies of these postsynaptic neurons. And these postsynaptic neurons, or postganglionic sympathetic fibers, will go and innervate organs like the liver, the spleen, adrenal glands, which is going to be specifically the medulla of the adrenal gland, stomach, intestines, kidneys, urinary bladder, etc. Now the somatic nerves, they are going to innervate, of course, skeletal muscle. So what are then the different pathways that a postganglionic fiber may follow? It can end in a ganglia and then go back and enter the synapses immediately within a postganglionic neuron to innervate organs at the same level. Or as I told you before, it can go up and down and then synapse at a ganglia of at different levels, and from there it will go and innervate the target organs. If you remember, the name of this system is called thoracolumbar. So why it can go up to a cervical level, or why it can go up to sacral or coccygeal levels? Well, because these fibers can go up and down, as we saw. And some of them, like the ones that are going to form what we call the splanchnic nerves in the abdominal cavity, it will bypass these chains, so it won't make a synapse with these postganglionic neurons. So again, these nerves in here, emerging from the upper thoracic level or the upper lumbar level, they can go up and innervate organs within the face, the neck, and also within the thorax, of course. These ones from the lower lumbar level, they can go down and then they can innervate organs like the male and female reproductive organs and the urinary bladder. So all of these in here in red are considered preganglionic neurons, and all of these in blue are considered postganglionic neurons. And of course, the postganglionic neurons are going to innervate the erector pili muscle and the blood vessels within our skin. So the nerve fibers that leaves the sympathetic chain will have three routes: spinal, sympathetic, and splanchnic nerves. The spinal nerve route are going to be these postganglionic fibers that exit the ganglion by the great ramus. They can return into the spinal nerve and go all the way into the target organ. And many of the sweat glands that we have also within the skin, or most of them, they are innervated by the sympathetic system. And also the pili erector muscles and the blood vessels within the skin and the skeletal muscles. So one of the reasons why, when someone is scared and it activates the sympathetic system, one of the reasons why the person starts sweating a lot, and sometimes their hair in the skin goes up or it has goosebumps, is because of this innervation. And if you think about it as well, so many people become pale. Why? Because when you innervate the system, these blood vessels in the skin will vasoconstrict, and the person is not going to have the normal skin tone, so it will look pale. So again, the sympathetic system goes and innervates the heart, the lungs, esophagus, thoracic blood vessels, because it will extend these nerves that are going to form what we call the carotid plexus, that is going to go around each carotid artery in the neck, and from there the fibers will go and innervate head structures like the sweat glands in our face, like the salivary glands, nasal glands, pili erector muscle, blood vessels, and this muscle in the iris that we call the dilator muscle. And then the fibers that goes into these organs in the head and the neck, they will connect first to the superior and middle cervical ganglia. From there, it will form cardiac nerves to the heart. And then the splanchnic nerves are formed from spinal nerves T5 through T12, and then it will lead to the second set of ganglia, collateral or prevertebral. This one is going to go in the middle, just anterior to the spinal cord. So we already see this, so let's move on. So the collateral ganglia in the abdominal cavity is going to form aortic plexus that is going to go around the abdominal aorta, and then from there you have these collateral ganglia, the celiac, superior mesenteric, and inferior mesenteric ganglia. And from there, the postganglionic fibers of these ganglia are going to go together with the arteries of the same name, so superior mesenteric, inferior mesenteric artery, and the celiac trunk, to innervate the different target organs within the abdominal cavity. And we have this plexus, or this collection of nerves, that are coming from the celiac and the superior mesenteric ganglia that we call the solar plexus. These nerves radiate from the ganglia like if they were rays of suns, so that's why it's called solar. So here is the diagram about this emerging of the sympathetic nervous system fibers from the abdominal cavity. So in here we have the celiac ganglia that it is located next to this artery that is called the celiac trunk. So the postganglionic fibers that are coming off from the celiac ganglia will follow the branches of the celiac trunk to innervate organs like the pancreas, the stomach, the liver, the spleen. And in here we have this superior mesenteric ganglion. And then in here we will have the aortic plexus, and then the inferior mesenteric ganglion in here. And these fibers will go following the different arteries that emerges from this aorta. This big artery that you see here is called the abdominal aorta. So some of these fibers will form what we call the renal plexus, and then the first lumbar sympathetic ganglion in here, the aortic plexus in here, and then in here we will have the pelvic sympathetic chain. And some of these will come directly coming up from this paravertebral. So this is the paravertebral chain or sympathetic chain, and this is the prevertebral chain. So they will come directly from there, and then you will innervate the adrenal medulla. So the adrenal medulla will secrete adrenaline or epinephrine. So these preganglionic cell branches make synapses to 10 to 20 postganglionic cells. So what it means is that you will have one neuron that can excite multiple postganglionic fibers, and then you can send the signal to different target organs. So you will have a widespread effect because of this, and also because you have innervation of the medulla of the adrenal gland, which is going to lead to the secretion of these hormones that you see here on the bottom of this slide, like the catecholamines, which are epinephrine or adrenaline, 85%, and 15% norepinephrine. And these will be released into the bloodstream, and they will have, of course, systemic effect because it will affect many systems. So this is a mid-sagittal cut of the adrenal gland. Another name for the adrenal gland is called suprarenal because it's above supra, the kidneys, suprarenal. So this area that you see here in pink color, this is the cortex. This is not innervated by the sympathetic system. So just this middle region, the one in purple, this is the medulla. Now, the parasympathetic system is also known as craniosacral division because it will have these nerves emerging from the brain, so cranial, and also from the sacral region, sacral. So these nerves have long preganglionic neurons, and they will come from the midbrain, the pons and the medulla oblongata, and the spinal nerves will emerge from S2, sacral 2 to S4. And then these preganglionic fibers will be so long, it will reach the target organs and it will connect within these ganglions that are near the target organs. So this parasympathetic division is more selective in the stimulation of target organs. It's not going to be having a widespread effect at the sympathetic system. So some of these branches of the parasympathetic system, which is part of the peripheral nervous system, is going to be these nerves, these cranial nerves. So cranial nerve number 3, which is called the oculomotor nerve, this one is going to innervate a muscle in the pupil that is called the radial muscle. When this muscle, circular muscle, when this muscle is innervated, the person is going to have constriction of the pupil. And this is going to create like a pinpoint pupil, and it will help for the lens to focus light into the retina, one part of the eye where we have cells that make us see. Now cranial nerve number 7, or facial nerve, is going to innervate lacrimal glands so we can produce tears. It's going to innervate also the nasal mucosa and salivary glands like the parotid gland. Glossopharyngeal nerve, or cranial nerve number 9, facial nerve is going to innervate general salivary glands, while glossopharyngeal nerve is going to, or cranial nerve number 9 is going to innervate the parotid gland, and cranial nerve number 10, the vagus nerve, is going to be the longest nerve in our body, part of the parasympathetic system, that is going to innervate viscerae within the thoracic cavity, but it can go into the abdominal cavity and innervate viscerae as far as the half of the large intestine. So it's going to have, while it's traveling down the abdominal and the thoracic cavity, it's going to form several plexuses like the cardiac, pulmonary, and esophageal plexuses. So this is the diagram to show you the segments of the craniosacral nerves and the target organs. So we have here cranial nerve number 3 that is going to connect to this ganglion that is called the ciliary ganglion that is found in the skull, and then this one is going to innervate the pupil. Now cranial nerve number 7 is going to connect here to this ganglion that is called pterygopalatine, and is going to innervate our lacrimal gland. Cranial number 7 is also going to connect to this submandibular ganglion, so it's going to innervate the submandibular gland. Now, glossopharyngeal nerve is going to connect to this otic ganglion and is going to innervate the parotid gland. Now, the vagus nerve, the longest nerve of the ANS, is going to innervate several organs. So it's going to innervate the heart, so it will decrease the heart rate. It's going to innervate the airways in the lungs, so it's going to bronchoconstrict the airways, so you have less air coming through the pulmonary plexus. It's going to innervate also some muscles, smooth muscle within the esophagus, so through the esophageal plexus. And then through these connections in the abdominal cavity, is going to innervate the liver, the stomach, pancreas, spleen, half of the colon, part of the, or all the intestines, the kidney, the ureters, the urinary bladder that are part of the urinary system, and also in the male, the penis, scrotum, and in females, the ovary and the uterus. And in order to do this, it uses these sacral nerves that are going to form what we call the pelvic splanchnic nerves. One difference between the sympathetic and parasympathetic system is the length of the fibers. So in the case for the parasympathetic system, the preganglionic fibers are long, and the postganglionic fibers are short. The ones in blue are short. And is the opposite for the sympathetic system. The postganglionic fibers are long, while the preganglionic fibers are short. Now, the preganglionic and the postganglionic fibers in the parasympathetic system, they always release acetylcholine. While in the sympathetic system, the preganglionic fibers, they release acetylcholine, and the postganglionic fibers, they release norepinephrine or epinephrine. A third division of the ANS is the ENS or enteric nervous system. This one, it is composed of 100 million neurons that are found in the walls of the digestive tract. It has its own reflex arcs. Some of them are short, some of them are long, but they help to regulate the motility of organs in the digestive system, like the esophagus, the stomach, the intestines, and also regulates the secretion of enzymes, the secretion of acid, and also the secretion of mucus by different glands within the digestive system. But this ENS, enteric nervous system, works together with the sympathetic and parasympathetic system. One of the problems that can happen if someone doesn't have a functional enteric nervous system, you can have a disease like what we call the Hirschsprung's disease. In this case, the person doesn't have innervation to the sigmoid in the colon, and then the muscles in this area do not contract because they don't have this innervation, so the feces won't pass and the feces become impacted, and it will dilate the colon into what we call the megacolon. This is a medical emergency, so the person which usually it's a newborn has to be undergoing surgery. So why some autonomic neurons have contrasting effects on the organs? Well, it's because no matter that both of them, sympathetic parasympathetic system, innervate the same organs, they secrete different neurotransmitters. So sympathetic system releases norepinephrine, while parasympathetic system acetylcholine. And you will have receptors for norepinephrine and for acetylcholine that opens different channels. Some of them, they open chloride channels, some of them, they open sodium channels, and that can lead to depolarization and activation of the target organ, or it can lead to hyperpolarization or inhibition of the target organ. So you have subdivision then of receptors for these different hormones or these different neurotransmitters, so that's why you have a different effect. So again, the sympathetic system, parasympathetic system releases only acetylcholine in the preganglionic and the postganglionic neurons. So the receptors into which acetylcholine is bound are called the cholinergic receptors. We have two types of cholinergic receptors. We have muscarinic in the cardiac muscle, smooth muscle, and some gland cells, and they will be excitatory or inhibitory because you have subclasses of muscarinic receptors. Nicotinic receptors will be found in all the postganglionic neurons of the ANS and also in the adrenal medulla. And also we will have some of them in the skeletal muscle. So they will have excitatory effect when you bind acetylcholine to these nicotinic receptors. Norepinephrine is always released by the sympathetic postganglionic neurons, and these are called adrenergic fibers because the other name for epinephrine is adrenaline. Now, the adrenergic receptors can be alpha or beta. If it's alpha, you will have a subdivision alpha 1 and alpha 2 that are connected to molecules within the cells or enzymes that acts like a second messenger. These alpha adrenergic receptors are usually excitatory, while the beta adrenergic receptors are usually inhibitory, and also we have a subdivision of the beta receptors that we call beta 1 and beta 2, and both act through cyclic AMP as a second messenger, the beta receptors. Sometimes this action of these fibers is indirect. So in the case of vasodilation, you will have an increased blood flow and increased secretion, and vasoconstriction, you will have a decreased flow and decreased secretion. And in the case of the sympathetic effects, they tend to last longer than the parasympathetic effects. So whenever you have norepinephrine released by the sympathetics, this will be reabsorbed by the nerve and it will start diffusing to adjacent cells, and then from there it will go into the bloodstream. While acetylcholine will be released into the synapse and will be recycled, if you remember, by this enzyme that we call acetylcholinesterase. Now, in order to prevent undesirable effects, we have modulators for the action of acetylcholine and norepinephrine. Some of these modulators in the sympathetic fibers will be substance P, encephaline, neuropeptide Y, somatostatin, neurotensin, organoleptorephine-releasing hormone. In the parasympathetic system, the modulators for release of this excitatory effect or inhibitory effect by these fibers will be nitric oxide that will cause vasodilation and inhibit the tone of the smooth muscle. In this case, this is important for penile erection. So in this figure, we have the different neurotransmitters shown of how they are released by these fibers. So this is a parasympathetic fiber. We have preganglionic fiber and postganglionic fiber. So if you see here, for this ACH, it will bind into nicotinic receptors, which is going to excite these postganglionic neurons so they can release ACH, and then this ACH is going to bind to these muscarinic receptors, and then you will have an effect on the target cell. For sympathetic adrenergic fibers, you have acetylcholine always released between preganglionic and postganglionic, which are going to bind to nicotinic receptors, just as this one. And then you have norepinephrine that is going to bind to the target cells. And in some cases for sympathetic system, you can have what we call sympathetic cholinergic fibers, in which you only release acetylcholine similarly as to the parasympathetic fiber. And of course, this acetylcholine will bind to muscarinic cell receptors. So the dual innervation coming from parasympathetic and sympathetic system has antagonistic effects, but also can have cooperative effects. So the two divisions will act on different effectors in that case to produce a unified effect overall. And both of them do not normally innervate an organ equally. So sometimes parasympathetic system will be more active in some organs, like in the digestive organs, and the sympathetic system will have a greater effect on the ventricular muscle of the heart. In the case of antagonistic effects, in the parasympathetic system, the heart rate decreases while the heart rate in the sympathetic increases. In the eyes, the sympathetic system will cause dilation of the pupils, while in the case of the parasympathetic system, you have constriction of the pupils. So dilation is called mydriasis, constriction is called meiosis. So in the case of cooperative effects, one example is that whenever you have both sympathetic and parasympathetic effects in the salivary glands, you increase secretion of the salivary glands. But in the case of the parasympathetic system, it's going to be serous cell secretion, while in the sympathetic system, it's going to be mucous cell secretion. So this is just to show you the dual innervation of the iris. So this muscle that goes like this away from the pupil, which is this opening, is called the radial muscle. And then in here, on the edge of the pupil, we have a round muscle that we call the circular muscle. Now, when you have both of them activating at the same time, you will have a normal diameter of your pupil. But when you have more sympathetic effect, your pupils will become mydriatic or dilated. But when you have more of this, the blue innervation coming from the parasympathetic system, you will have meiosis or meiotic pupils, so constricted pupils. This innervation by the parasympathetic system is carried by oculomotor nerve, cranial nerve number 3. So this is just a summary of what we covered. Now, sometimes some organs don't have a dual innervation, like in the case of the adrenal medulla. Adrenal medulla is only innervated by the sympathetic fibers, as well the erector pili muscles, the sweat glands, and the many blood vessels. So in the case of the sympathetic fibers, then when you have innervation of the blood vessels with much effect of the sympathetic system, then other times you have constriction or decreased size of the diameter, so you can have increased blood pressure. But sometimes when you have less innervation of the sympathetic system, you will have vasodilation. So this then help us to regulate the blood pressure and the routes of the blood flow, because sometimes you don't want to have blood flow into areas that are not necessary. So in any case, you have a sympathetic vasomotor tone, that it is the number of action potentials that are generated per unit of time, and this is what we call a baseline firing frequency. This will keep the vessels in a state of partial constriction, and in the case of increase of the firing frequency, when you increase the number of action potentials, you will have vasoconstriction. And then when you decrease the rate of action potentials, you will have vasodilation. And again, you can shunt the blood from one organ to another as needed in the case of an emergency, when you're scared. Again, you will constrict the blood vessels from the skin and also from the digestive viscera to send the blood into the muscles and the heart. That is going to be necessary for fight or flight. In the case of times of emergency, the sympathetic system again will prioritize the sending of blood into the skeletal muscle and the heart. And whenever you have a bleeding because of an injury, of course, you will have the sympathetic system become activated, so you can have vasoconstriction, so that you can have less bleeding. So this is an example of a strong sympathetic tone. So you have an increase, if you can see in this line, sending of action potentials along this nerve that innervates this area. And then that is going to innervate the smooth muscle around the arteries, so you can have vasoconstriction. When you don't need this, you will have decreased firing of the action potentials. So you have weaker sympathetic tone. Your smooth muscles within the arteries won't be innervated as much, so they will have relaxation, and this will lead to vasodilation. See the title, sympathetic of the slide, sympathetic and vasomotor tone. So what it means is that parasympathetic system doesn't have an effect in the blood vessels. We regulate the functioning of the ANS at different levels in the CNS. So the cerebral cortex can influence your response. So you may feel anger, fear, and anxiety that is going to send signals into an area of the brain that it is in charge of processing these signals, the limbic system and the hypothalamus, so you can perform certain functions. So for instance, in the hypothalamus, you can have this activation of hunger, thirst, and also libido. In the midbrain, pons medulla oblongata will have these centers, cardiovascular centers, so cardiac and vasomotor control will be given by this area of the brain. And then you can increase salivation, swallowing, sweating, bladder control, and pupillary changes. One of the reasons why, speaking about pupillary changes, one of the reasons why in cases of emergency or when you're scared, why you dilate your pupils upon activation of the sympathetic system is so you can gather more light and you can see better and you can run or fight. That's why we have our eyes being dilated, our pupils. Now, in the spinal cord, we have these reflexes that controls defecation, micturition, and also we have control over these because we have these skeletal muscle sphincters. And if the spinal cord is damaged, the smooth muscle of the bowel and the bladder is controlled by the autonomic reflexes that are built into the spinal cord. So our ANS can be influenced by some drugs. And in the case of the drugs that increases the functioning of the sympathetic system are called sympathomimetics. And this will stimulate receptors or increase the release of norepinephrine. Examples we have called medicines that has drugs that dilate the bronchioles or constrict the nasal blood vessels. Sympatholytics will be the ones that has an opposite effect or diminish the sympathetic activity. So they will block receptors or inhibit the release of norepinephrine. Examples, we have beta blockers that decreases the blood pressure, and also decreases the contractility of the heart and the innervation of the blood vessels. Parasympathetic mimetics will be the ones that enhances the activation of the parasympathetic system, while parasympatholytics will be the opposite. So in the case of drugs that act on the CNS neurotransmitters, we have this drug Prozac that blocks the reuptake of a neurotransmitter that is called serotonin, that increases the person's effect. So you will have in the mood, so you will have mood elevating effect. And then caffeine will compete with adenosine. The presence of caffeine in our bloodstream will bind to these receptors. So this is caffeine that will block the receptors that are special for this drug that is called adenosine. So if you see here, this part is very similar. So when you block these receptors that are supposed to bind adenosine, instead of being sleepy, the person is going to be awake. Okay, so this is all for this chapter. Email me with any questions. But before, let me tell you the key points for this chapter. So what are some of the effects of the sympathetic system? Increased blood pressure, increased heart rate, increased sweating, and increased blood glucose. Now, the receptors in the aorta that monitors changes in the blood pressure and are under the control of the ANS are baroreceptors. We have within the brainstem these neurons that are called the reticular activation system that helps to maintain a person alert or conscious. So RAS, or reticular activation system, maintains a person conscious or alert. And then if someone has damage to this reticular activating system, the person will become unconscious. And then the person cannot be aroused upon applying a strong stimulus. This condition is known as coma. So damage to the RAS, in which the person becomes unconscious and is not being capable of being aroused because of strong stimulus, like if you're pinching the person's skin really hard and the person doesn't awake, that it is known as coma. And some of the functions of the ANS is to control blood pressure, heart rate, and digestion processes. So the centers that controls this blood pressure, heart rate, and digestion processes are located in the medulla oblongata. Okay, so I think those are all of these key points, and I will, in the next chapter, when I do this video lecture, I will let you know if I miss any of the key points. But I think I cover everything that you need to know for this chapter. Anyway, some of you have a good day and some of you have a good night. Bye-bye.